Church, God bless you. God bless you all in the name of Jesus Christ. Just thinking about you, I wanted to put this video together to kind of share the thoughts the Lord has recently been sharing with me. We are all in this situation together. Of course, referring to this pandemic crisis that we have to deal with in society today. And it's taken its toll on me too, right? The being so restricted, my movement being restricted, it's kind of taken its toll, right? And so I've been spending a lot of time in prayer, just simply talking to the Lord. I might be coming across as a little hoarse. it's because my throat's a little sore. I've been here. I'm in my office in the church. And I've been here and I've been praying in the sanctuary by myself, just getting right with God, right? Just consecrating myself over to Him. I want to make sure that I'm in sync with what thus saith the Lord. I want to make sure that I'm in sync with His word, with the leading of His spirit, et cetera, et cetera. And so I found myself just simply crying out to Him, asking Him for something fresh from His, something fresh from His word. And so I want to share my thoughts with you. I have a brief passage that I'd like to share with you. Well, at least at this point, it's a sermonette. Now, we're not in our sanctuaries, so I'm not pressed for time. So I'm not necessarily going to allow myself to be sensitive for time. 8-minute video, 10, 15. Listen, let's fellowship. Let's talk. Let's break bread together. Put this on pause right now. If you don't already have your Bibles in front of you, and let's read together. Let's fellowship together. Amen. And I want you to go with me to the book of Exodus, chapter 14. I'm going to be reading a few verses, verses 10 through 16. And by the way, I pray that you are well. I pray that you're taking care of yourselves, doing everything that you possibly can. I pray that you have the things that you need in your home. And in the event that you need some toilet paper, I should have had a roll of toilet paper right here on my desk so I can show it to you right now. I got a box. Two, in fact, have been donated to us. So if you need toilet paper, just give me a text. Let me know. All right. We'll get some paper to you. I'll put it in a grocery bag and I'll set it on your doorstep. Right. That that way there's no contact between us. Thank you, Lord. Exodus 14, 10 through 16. When Pharaoh drew near, the people of Israel lifted up their eyes, and behold, the Egyptians were marching after them, and they feared greatly, And the people of Israel cried out to the Lord. And notice it says, and the people of Israel. So these were God's people, right? So we got to remember these things because we got to touch on these things in a few moments. And they said to Moses, is it because there are no graves in Egypt that you have taken us away to die in the wilderness? What have you done to us, bringing us out of Egypt? Is not this what we said to you in Egypt? Leave us alone that we may serve the Egyptians. For it would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians than to die in this wilderness. And Moses said to the people, fear not, stand firm and see the salvation of the Lord. I want to read some more, but I want to just pause right there. I want to read that again because it should resonate with your spirit and mind today. We too are God's people, and we're going through a little situation today. God delivered the Hebrew people from Egypt. No sooner they find themselves outside of Egypt, they find themselves in the wilderness, journeying through the wilderness. We'll talk about that in a few moments, but they got discouraged. There was no bread, no food, no et cetera, at least not the type that they were they had grown accustomed to. And they started complaining and murmuring to Moses, to Aaron, to Miriam, and ultimately to God. So this is what happens to us when we find ourselves in the wilderness. So this is should have given you the title by now. I apologize. It is Wilderness Perspective. Wilderness Perspective. This is kind of a follow-up to what I stated not this past Sunday because Pastor Roy preached, but the Sunday before, I was talking about eternal perspective. In fact, that was the theme of the message. Well, that's the theme of this message as well. Eternal perspective. That's the theme, but the title is wilderness perspective. And Moses said to the people, picking up again in the Bible, "Fear not, stand firm and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will work for you today. For the Egyptians whom you see today, you shall never see again. The Lord will fight for you, and you have only to be silent." Reminds me of Psalms 46:10. The Lord said to Moses, "Why do you cry to me? Tell the people of Israel to go forward. Lift up your staff and stretch out your hand over the sea and divide it, that the people of Israel may go through the sea on dry ground." Amen. Praise God. So as we stated already in this particular passage, God had already delivered his people with a mighty outstretched arm from Egypt. He destroyed the gods of Egypt with the plagues that kind of, we can safely say, plagues that rained down upon Egypt. Then he gave them a promise. He told them that they were going to find themselves in a land flowing with milk and honey. The promised land. So he made promises to them. They leave Egypt. But in this particular passage, they find themselves between a rock and a hard place, if you will. On the one side of them, they have the Red Sea. It was vast. It was huge. It was unpassable, at least relative to their perspective. And then on the other side of them was Pharaoh's army that was indeed advancing upon them. And they lose sight of God because of that particular situation. I want to share a quick point with you here. It's not one of the points that I have. I have a few points that I want to share with you, but this is a power principle. And I want you to make note of, and you don't have to necessarily write because you could just rewind this and you can do whatever it is you need to do with this. But I want you to consider this. We can never maintain our focus on the promises of God while our hearts are committed to iniquity. I'm going to read that again. We can never maintain our focus on the promises of God while our hearts are committed to iniquity. And why do I mention that at this point in this particular lesson? It's because God gave his people a promise. He delivered them from Egypt. He demonstrated to them that he indeed is God and that he indeed was with them in every way, shape, or form. But no sooner they leave Egypt and they find themselves in this precarious setting in Exodus chapter 14 when they lost sight of God. And why did they lose sight of God? Because of their sin. Because of their sin. I shouldn't have to read the passage to you, the preceding chapter, the proceeding chapter, and all of chapter 14 so that we can get this impression that there was a lot of murmuring. There was a lot of stuff going on there. So what's the point? There was sin in the camp, sin in their lives. And it's the idea that sin will always cause us to lose sight of the promises of God. Here it is. Let's extrapolate just a little bit more, right? We know that when Paul the Apostle, I'm thinking about Romans chapter 7, when Paul the Apostle was making this emphasis on the dual nature, dual, D-U-A-L, forgive my pronunciations, my accent. We have this dual nature. We have a natural sinful nature, rather sinful nature, but then we have this spiritual nature, a part of us that wants to serve God and the other part of us that doesn't want to serve the Lord, not even a little bit. That's the fallen nature within us. But thank God that we are saved. And so Paul was placing this emphasis that when we are spiritual, when our minds are in the spirit, and we are in sync with the Lord, when we are walking with God and we are sensitive to what he has to say to us in his word and we're actually living it out, we begin to develop this acute sensitivity for the things that pertain to God. But what happens when we allow sin to enter our camp, just like the Hebrew people did, then we begin to lose sensitivity for the things that pertain to God, as I just finished describing. And we begin to develop a sensitivity for sin. And that's why Paul the Apostle, again, just thinking outside the box here, Paul the Apostle addressed the Corinthians in this way. In the first chapter of the first book of Corinthians, and if I'm not mistaken, in the first chapter of the second book of Corinthians, when he addresses them, one of the things that he highlights is that Paul acknowledged that there were miracles occurring in the lives of the Corinthians. And not because he was there, because he wasn't, but because they were Christians. They were, in fact, believers. But he also took the time throughout the rest of those letters to emphasize their carnal nature. You see that? Their dual nature. On the one hand, they were believers, but because of this, they were Greeks. And so because of their sensitivity for these natural things, quote unquote, they lost the sensitivity they should have maintained as believers. And that happens with you and I today as well. We're not focused on the things that pertain to God. We're not praying. If we're not reading, if we're not coming to church, if we're not fellowshipping, we're not fasting, right? Because from time to time, we have to fast, right? And if I can take my time here, I know you want mine. There are certain weaknesses that we possess today that we will never be able to overcome until we fast. Oh, it's a fact. Jesus Christ addressed us. Anyway, I digress. Let's keep going. We can never maintain our focus on the promises of God while our hearts are committed to iniquity. If there is ever such a thing that would serve to destabilize our faith as believers, it is sin, right? Because when we open the doors to sin, we begin to develop a dependence upon the flesh to get us through all of our circumstances. They essentially become idols, or the sin in our lives, they become idols. These are things that begin to drastically interfere with our eternal perspective. For example, don't deny me here, right? Be transparent. How would you respond if you had to give up your cell phones for one 24-hour period? How would you feel if you had to give up your cell phones for one 24-hour period? Ouch. My point exactly, right? You know exactly how you would feel if you had to give up your phones. I know how. I mean, I can admit that. I'm not dependent upon it, right? Because I like to read the Word of God. So I don't read the Bible on my tablet or on my phone. I open up the physical Bible. But I enjoy communicating with you. I enjoy reaching out to my family back east, etc. So to some degree, there's some dependence. But if you take it from me, I'm going to live. I promise you that. Anyway, it was just a point. There are things in our lives that when removed from us, everything sort of falls apart. How would you feel if I took your car keys from you for one day or for one week? How would you feel? I think the point is clear. There are things that we depend upon in our lives. And when these things are removed, we kind of fall apart, right? Was God surprised by the response he received from his people in this particular passage? Was he surprised by their carnal nature? Was he surprised by their instability? No, he wasn't surprised at all. The key thing to understand here is that God always looks to validate the faith of his people through difficult times. He knew exactly what they were comprised of, exactly what they were made of, where they were with their nature when he called them out of Egypt, just like he knows where you and I are with our faith. Salvation is not determined by perfection, right? Never has. It isn't today, and it never will be. Salvation will always be determined by our faith in a risen Savior, and his name is Jesus Christ, right? But when God calls us out of darkness, he calls us out of our bondage, he always looks to validate faith within us. Why? The promise in this one particular passage, right, was that they were heading somewhere. They had a wonderful destination carved out before them. It was a promised land. It was a land flowing with milk and honey. God wasn't going to tell them that they were going to go through some stuff along the way, right? We talked about that two Sundays ago. Why is it that we go through some dire circumstances? Why is it that God doesn't give us a backstage pass so that we can see behind the scenes of what it is he's doing, what he's setting us up for? Why doesn't he give us advance notice about the circumstances that we're going to find ourselves in? The fact is that he has, and he does. He doesn't give us all the specifics, but in his word said it first. We know in Matthew 24 that the things that we're experiencing today with this COVID-19 situation, Jesus talked about it, maybe not specifically, but he said these things would happen. Isaiah talked about it, Micah, Malachi, Zechariah, Daniel talked about it. And of course, the first few chapters, or all of the book of Revelation actually, talks about it. And that's where we find ourselves in God's prophetic timeline. We find ourselves actually these days, we're living out some of the things that Jesus Christ talked about, for sure. And God doesn't give us a backstage pass. He simply asks us to trust him. He challenges us. And through the process, as we today, right, as we are heading to our promised land, he not only asks us to simply trust him, right, but he makes sure that we go through certain things that will serve to purify our faith. He wants to make us more like him on a daily basis. That is God's objective. Now, we don't like to entertain this subject. Who does, right? Nobody likes to entertain the subject of persecution, the subject of trials and tribulations. Oh, this is God. We hear it all the time, right? From one another, those who are more mature in the faith, right? We listen, just have faith. Just have faith. Well, try, you know, you try living that out when you find yourself going through what I'm going through, right? Quote unquote. Well, the fact is, it just because we're going through something, it doesn't mean that God is not behind the scenes working something out on our behalf, in our behalf. What is it? I'm thinking of a verse. I don't necessarily have it right here in front of me. It's 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 17. The Bible actually states that judgment begins with the house of God first. Oh, yes. Judgment begins in the house of God. And we know that this is a crisis that's happening in the world today. God's not out to destroy us. He's not out to harm us. He's not going to heap something upon us that we are not able to handle. This is 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13, right? We can endure, we can make it through this, but we have to trust in him in spite of what is happening in our lives together. Anyway, let's just move on. Thinking about the Exodus from Egypt, imagine the joy in the hearts of God's people when they hear from Moses, when they learned that they were going to be free, that they were going to be delivered in a mighty way. And then think about their response when they found out that they were going to lose some of the comforts that they had grown accustomed to while in Egypt. No showers. Huh? Imagine that. There were no more showers. They had no comfortable beds in the wilderness. There were no steak dinners. And this is where I wish I had that roll of toilet paper again, right? They had no toilet paper. And they were complaining. They were murmuring to Moses. They were murmuring to Aaron. They were murmuring to everyone who would listen. And ultimately, we know they were murmuring before God. They were rebellion. Their hearts were slipping away from the promise that God had made to them. And they were being rebellious in that sense. Listen, it may sound funny, right? But it's in our nature to develop a dependence upon natural things. That's just what happens when there are some things that God wants to remove from our lives, some things that actually serve as a hindrance, right? So if my cell phone is costing me or bringing compromise to my faith, then somehow, some way, God's going to take it from me. How many of you have ever found yourself dealing with a situation where you've lost something? You've lost one of your, not loved ones. I'm not talking about that. not talking about your loved ones dying or anything like that, but losing some of your toys, having to sell some things, or having certain things stolen from you, never to retrieve them again. I know we don't like to talk about this stuff, but it's true. I've personally lost some things like that myself. And I know that somehow, some way, God is looking after me. He's doing whatever it is whatever it is that it's necessary to make sure that my faith is enhanced because I am his child. He just simply wants us to trust him. Amen. So long story short, the children of Israel, the Hebrew people, they find themselves entering the promised land only after, now get this, they entered the promised land only after they were sanctified and not before. The wilderness experience was necessary. They didn't know it. They certainly didn't believe it. It's at least not the generation 20 years and older that came out of Egypt. That's the generation that rebelled against God greatly. And so what is it God said to Moses? They're not going in. They're not going in. Everybody 20 and older died in the wilderness. A journey that should have only taken a week, maybe a little over a week, took them 40 long years. Why? Because of their rebellion. God was sanctifying them. So the same thing applies to you and I today. Point number one, our wilderness experience. Our wilderness experience. Can we characterize this season with COVID-19 as a wilderness experience? I think so. I think so. God's not surprised by it. He's not surprised by it. Right? Or is he? In no way, shape, or form. He knows exactly what is happening. And God is capable of using it to draw us closer to himself. And that's the point here with the wilderness experience that God allows us to go through. And not only that, there's a flip side to this as well. When things like this happen on the world stage, God looks to draw God's people closer to himself. But secondly, God looks to draw sinners to himself. God is not out to destroy us. He's not out to cast people to hell. He's out to give us a choice. He's out to put Christ out in front of us so that we can really take a good look and realize the opportunity he affords to us, the opportunity to be saved. How difficult is it for us to believe that God is using this crisis to draw us closer to himself? I think the point is clear. The verse that I cited a few moments back, 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 17, I believe it is, I believe I'm right, that judgment begins with the house of God. So God is looking to enhance our faith. He's looking to awaken his church. Let me ask you this. Just thinking outside the box here, taking my time with this. Isn't it true that you've been reading more now that you've been in the house quarantined? Isn't it also true that you've been praying more? Isn't it true that we've been praying for certain friends and certain loved ones a lot more lately because we've been quarantined? What? And this, you know, this is tough, right? Why is it that we require difficult circumstances like this in order to shake off the cobwebs, maybe remove the dust from our Bibles, from the surface of our Bibles, clean it off and break it open, crack it open so that we can read, learn a little bit more about God, learn to appreciate him. Somebody once told me long ago, Christianity is not determined by what we know. Christianity has always been determined by who we know. It's not about how much Bible we memorize. It's not about how much of it we've become acquainted with. Some of us can recite whole passages. Some of us know all the stories in the Bible. But what good does it? What impact is it really having on my life? Let me make it personal, right? If I don't pray, if I don't seek the face of God, Christianity is determined by relationship with the Almighty God. It's not about information. It's never been about information. And I hope you understand that point. I want you to listen to this verse. I'm going to read, cite three verses here to you. Matthew 4:4, Matthew 6:33, and 1 Peter 4:12. First verse, Matthew 4:4. It says, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word which proceeds out of the mouth of God. There it is. That's where our dependence should be. Relative to this point, when we find ourselves in the midst of our wilderness experience, there's this dependence that we are supposed to have on God, not on natural things, not on philosophy, pseudosciences, not on intellectualism or education. Those things, they're a plus. But I will always emphasize a dependence on Jesus Christ. I will always make an emphasis on a relationship with my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Always, because that is key. When we get his word on the inside of us, his word changes us. It transforms us. Not when we memorize it, not when we become acquainted with it, not when we share it to people like I'm sharing it with you, but when we actually take ownership of it. That's when the real difference begins to happen. When we allow it to inherently transform us, to fundamentally transform our lives. When we allow the word of God to filter out of us our sinful nature, to filter out of us the sin that easily besets us. When we allow the word of God to make us more like Jesus, that's what God looks to accomplish in our lives. When he allows for pandemics like the one we find ourselves in right now, he wants to save the unsaved, and he wants to draw believers closer to himself. Matthew 6:33, seek you first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Wilderness experience, our wilderness experience. While we're going through the things that we're going through with this pandemic, we have to trust in God. We have to seek him first. We have to strive for the things that pertain to God and trust that in the midst of all of it, God will flood in our direction the things that we need. Hasn't he been taking care of your needs? God was trying to get this message across to the Hebrew people when he delivered them from Egypt, but they lost sight of it, right? The promised land was sort of, it became blurred, extremely blurred, because of the sin that entered their lives. And lastly, the verse that I want to share with you relative to this point is 1 Peter 4:12. It says, beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery trial when it comes upon you to test you, as though something strange were happening to you. We are children of God, but God indeed allows for certain things to happen in our lives so that he can draw us closer to himself. We're going to see this a little bit differently from a different angle with this next point, point number two, sanctification. Sanctification, it means to set apart, from sin unto God. And this is the one subject that nobody likes to entertain, right? But it's true. Nobody likes to entertain it, but it is definitely true. It is a biblical concept. The Bible teaches that judgment must begin with the church, doesn't it not? I just mentioned that verse to you, and there it is. I knew I had it in there, had it on my notes, but I'm just going to keep going. And concerning the difficulties that we find ourselves going through right now, and yes, there are grave difficulties. I want to read another verse to you, another passage. This is 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 9 through 12. 1 Peter 5, 9 through 12. It says, resist him, firm in your faith, knowing that the same kinds of suffering are being experienced by your brotherhood throughout the world. And after you have suffered a little while, the God of all grace, who has called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore, confirm, strengthen, and establish you. That's 1 Peter chapter 5, 9 and 10. And there it is again. The point is clear. From the word of God, God allows for certain circumstances to make us more like himself. And the point is, at least the one concept that we have to walk away with is that God is in control, number one. And secondly, that he wants to enhance our faith. He wants to enhance our faith. Look at this. Listen to this particular verse. Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. The first portion of verse 2. It says, therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight of sin. Boom. Underline that. Highlight that. Do whatever you have to do. It says, let us also lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith. So God allows certain circumstances to invade our lives. He asks us to trust him. He asks us to consecrate ourselves to him when we find ourselves in dire circumstances, like we are right now with this COVID-19 pandemic crisis that's sweeping the world. It's difficult. God is asking us to trust him. Amen. Point number three, a land flowing with milk and honey. Now, relative to the passage that we read in Exodus chapter 14, the children of Israel, I know I mentioned this briefly already, but they just want to give perspective here. The children of Israel, they were given the promise that they were going to a promised land, a wonderful place. And in fact, we know that when Moses' spies, like Joshua and Caleb and a few others, when they came back from spying out the land of Canaan, what is it the Bible says they discovered in the land of Canaan? I mean, they actually had to carry a cluster of grapes between probably, I think the Bible does say this, between a rod or a stick or something, and between themselves because it was so heavy. Grapes, massive grapes. Using my imagination, they probably resembled cantaloupes. They were huge, right? Everything in the land was huge. The walls of Jericho were huge. In fact, the people were huge. The sons of Anak, the Anakites, they were giants in the land. Everything was huge. The land was fertile in so many different ways. This was going to become their land. They ventured out. Sin entered their lives. They lost sight, they rebelled against God, and they died in the wilderness, most of them. Only those who inherited the promise were those who were 19 years old and younger. 19 years old and younger. A land flowing with milk and honey. God has given us a promise too. And yet the promise that we have, that we've been given, is greater than the land of Canaan. It's greater than the land of Israel. Oh, that was a wonderful land. It still is to this day, but it doesn't compare with the promise that God has given us as his children, as God's children, as Christians. One day we are going to walk the streets of gold. And when I conclude here in a few moments, in probably less than 5 minutes, I want to read a portion of the book of Revelation, a chapter 21, a portion. And when you get the opportunity, I want you to read the whole chapter of Revelation 21. Read the entire chapter because it'll serve to give you eternal perspective regarding our future homeland, our future destination. And the reason why that's so important is because if we can maintain our focus on the promise, right? If we can keep it fixed on our minds and on our hearts and never losing sight of it, it'll make the difference when we find ourselves going through difficult situations this side of heaven. It's Revelations. I want to read a couple of verses to you. This is I think it's the first three verses, and I'm going to close. Then I'm going to close. It says, then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more, neither shall be mourning, neither shall there be mourning, no crying, no pain anymore, for the former things have passed away. Amen, amen, and amen. What wonderful perspective from the Word of God. Right? What wonderful perspective. That's the promise that we have. But God never promised that we weren't going to go through some things before reaching our promise. The idea that is that he wants to make us more like himself. He wants to refine us. He wants to be able to see his reflection on the surface of our lives. He wants for us to have our minds made up regarding our identities in Christ Jesus. And he also wants us to make a difference in the lives of people who do not know him. There are a lot of people who do not know Jesus in this world. We Christians are the minority in that sense. And so God has put a word in our hearts. Now more than ever, we need to be faithful and focused to God. And we need to share the gospel with those who do not know Jesus. Amen. I want to pray.
Well, thank you so much for our time in your presence here today. Thank you so much for the wisdom you give us from your word. Thank you so much for how you are using the circumstances in our lives to transform us, to refine us, to make us more like you. Father, you know we love you. Help us, Lord God, during this time. Help us with this consecration thing, this sanctification thing, this eternal perspective thing. Help us to yield ourselves to you. Allow ourselves to be changed and transformed and renewed, and allow us to wake up every single day that you bless us with life, Lord God, and to affirm the things that pertain to you in our lives, to take ownership of these things. And help us, Lord God, to be still and know that you are God, to resolve this situation that we find ourselves in. We love you, and we thank you so much, Lord God. We pray your blessings on all your people. I pray your blessings on the church and the leadership of this church and the families that we represent, especially those who do not know you as Lord and Savior. Bless us in drawing us to you, all of us. We thank you for it all, Lord God, in the blessed name of Jesus Christ. And all of God's people say, amen. I love you. God bless you. Until next time. Amen.